It's my pleasure to engage to introduce the second speaker, Peter Cheritish, who is a comprehensive HIV prevention specialist. Is based in the Kenyan Department of Health, where he's responsible for many of the prevention programs, very successful circumcision programs, and other HIV prevention programs within Kenya. He's going to be talking to us about implementation science and African perspective, and then we'll form part of the panel as soon as he returns. Thank you. Over to you, Peter.
Thank you for the invitation to present at Interest 2020. My name is Peter Cheritich from the Ministry of Health in Kenya. And I'm going to present to you on the African perspective to implementation science. Now, I'm going to just talk briefly about why implementation science is extremely important in Africa. I'm also going to just give you a few examples of what is being done on implementation science in the continent. And then I'm going to share my thoughts as to how we can actually improve the field of implementation science in Africa. So, yes, I think we all know that Africa suffers from, low indicators, low health outcomes. But more importantly, it's also the region where it has the lowest researcher population density, and also the spending on research is at the lowest. So it's extremely important that we actually motivate that element of research, including implementation science. But thanks to, North-South collaboration on the right side of your slide, you can actually see the number of publications that have been submitted and published around implementation science. And you can see they're growing over time. And most of these publications are in Africa. So yes, there is increased awareness of the need to do implementation science research, not only globally, but also in Africa. So, and some of the work that is being done, again, through collaborative networks, is work around, implementing, efficient mechanisms of health systems delivery. And in this work by Rachel Stuke and colleagues, there is a demonstration of what NIH through the PMCT cascade is funding across the continent in terms of improving the PMCT cascade by either using systems approaches so that you alter the healthcare system in a way that's more efficient, or they could actually be things that are targeted towards the individual on improving initiation, retention, and adherence. There are studies that are also looking at sociocultural approaches and also those that are looking at impact assessment approaches, either within a component of the cascade or through the entire PMCT cascade. And these are some of the exciting works that are happening and are likely also to yield results in terms of how we can improve our PMCT programs. There are tools also that have been developed to be able to really refine and understand in a more granular manner the cascade, either from the facility level, from ANC all the way to delivery and identification of an HIV-infected mother and also child, and also cascades that pick up from there, from an HIV-exposed child all the way through enrollment to ART. And these tools can actually be used and rolled out in settings, in ANC settings, and can actually be used by health workers on a routine basis to be able to really define where are the bottlenecks in their system and what can they do. And therefore, based on that, they can actually apply quality improvement methods to be able to change their outcomes. In this work by Kenny Scher, working in Mozambique, used a systems analysis improvement approach, where basically, yes, you have done your cascade analysis and you've seen these are the challenges. This is where children drop off. Then you actually work with the facility, you work with implementers to identify bottlenecks and then modify the workflow and in a cyclical manner, also look at how you can actually be able to make improvements and measure the those improvements. This is work also that you can potentially do impact evaluation using rigorous methods, just like step-weight control trials. This is work that is happening in Mozambique, and I think it's quite exciting. So there's a lot that is being done. This is just a snapshot of a few that are being done. But then there's still a big challenge because implementation science doesn't seem to have gained enough traction on the continent. And one of the reasons is probably because there's a limited understanding on the role of implementation science. A lot of people are still confusing it with operational research, and even some research institutes are actually more oriented towards basic and epidemiological research. And furthermore, there are limited skills intercontinent on impact evaluation, advanced statistical methods, and even optimization model. That is extremely important, particularly when you're looking at health systems improvements, how you can be able to optimize your human resource, your financial resources towards some certain outcomes. And I think also one of the reasons why we're not really galloping is the collaborations that are existing are not optimal. And so we need to really make sure that, beyond the work of NIH and WHO, we bring everybody on board, including the ministries of health. Now, what I consider to be some of the key challenges that are facing implementation science in Africa, and this is a few thoughts that I do have, is across the entire spectrum of data that's available for policymakers to use, like the cost, the training, et cetera, and also the supply chain systems, which of those actually are the most critical in sort of moving things to scale up, tilting the balance of the scale so that people can actually take up those research findings. And then this is a quintessential question, is at what point do researchers, particularly basic researchers, can begin to actually have a connection with the policymaker? So there's that smooth translation of the research findings to policy and eventually to practice. And something that I have also witnessed in my work around HIV and implementation of programs is sometimes there is sort of the need to really implement programs quickly, of course, to save lives. And at the same time, you need to make sure that you have a rigorous design to evaluate those public health programs. Now, sometimes, of course, you are not able to do both at the same time, and you're not able to inbuild a rigorous evaluation into public health programs. So should we sometimes just work with programs so that we have a mechanism to evaluate these programs? I think that's a question that is there. The other question for consideration, which I think is important, is sometimes we think about research capacity in different ways, and our understanding is different. And for agencies that are planning to build a research infrastructure in Africa, in particular, there has to be that common understanding. And so what is a critical mass of implementation scientists? Are they PhD trained? Are they MPH trained? Are they those who've attended short courses? Do you need an inventory of researchers who have led NIH-funded implementation science studies and say, okay, fine, if you have been a PI on a research that does IS and you're in Africa, is that sufficient capacity? Is research capacity also the existence of a network that then is able to apply for grants and be able to answer questions? Or could also that be seen to be, if there is sufficient collaboration between researchers in the North and researchers in Africa, and that collaboration seems to be working, can we also say that is a research capacity? And then, of course, the role of public health institutes and research agencies really needs to be defined. As I would mention again later on, a lot of them are working mainly on basic research, epidemiological research, but there's a way they can actually partner with some of the implementing agencies so that they can be able to support, particularly impact evaluation and defining how programs can be improved. So there's a question then is, what should be our focus as we move forward? I think one of the things we need to do is that we need to improve our training capacity at the moment. There are few schools that are training implementation science students at a high level. University of Washington is one of them. Melbourne, Australia is one of them. I am aware, I think, that University of Wits is also doing that in South Africa and many others. But I think the most important thing is that we need to bring this training to Africa. We need to integrate it in the curricula of schools of public health or schools of medicine or whatever is appropriate. And then the other thing we need is that we have to have a customized approach to the theoretical frameworks that govern, or rather that inform implementation science research, so that they are more applicable to Africa. What Dr. Shora and colleagues have put up would still need to be improved because of the unique sociocultural setting that we do have. So I think this is just a thought that I do have in terms of how we can continue to contextualize implementation science within the African setting. There is implementation science and its ethics, which I'm not going to really emphasize. It's extremely important that as much as most of implementation science research is real world research, it still should be subject to sufficient ethical safeguards, just like basic science research. Now, the other thing that I feel we need to focus, and this is probably more applicable to Africa than many other settings, is that given that resources are relatively more limited and in African settings, and given that, you know, within the next decade or so, we might not actually have sufficient resources, there's a lot of scope using the resources that we have to actually define mechanisms that are more cost effective, that are optimizing. And this is part of the work that we did, trying to really understand if you're to integrate NCD and HIV work and implementation science, what would sort of be the priority questions? And we came up with some of these priority questions, which most of them really evolve around the question of making things work better with the resources that are existing. So assuming that resources are limited, and they of course are limited, how can you sort of stretch the dollar a little bit more? And I think most of implementation science questions should be around those domains. And again, I think this is a nice paper by Yapa and colleagues, also just sort of putting out some of the implementation science questions that are out there and what is being done. Again, as you can see, there's a lot of discussion around task shifting, around new models of care, you know, how we can basically improve the way we work, how we can put task sharing, and even what I call sort of the ultimate task shifting, which is, individuals actually supervising their own testing. So I think studying or putting a lot of resources, implementation science resources, in studying, questions that eventually lead to the ultimate task shifting are extremely important questions for the African setting. So if we have to improve utilization of implementation science in Africa, some of the things that we need to do as proposed here is that, particularly for large-scale programs like immunization, HIV, and malaria, implementation science should be integrated into that from the funding perspective, so that as a grant is being given, there is an implementation science protocol attached to it that then is able to evaluate its impact. And then I also believe that there's a lot we can do from routine data, that if we build our surveillance system, our health information system properly, appropriately, with sufficient safeguards and unique personal identifiers, then we can be able to actually evaluate our programs more efficiently using quasi-experimental studies like time series. And then I always say this, that ministries of health are ministries of implementation science. So we need advocacy at the highest levels so that we can be able to get ownership from ministries of health, WHO country representatives, etc. And then we need to continue building implementation science alliances beyond the ones that are existing. Lastly, just a few thoughts on, in the era of COVID-19, what do we see in terms of opportunities for implementation science, particularly in Africa? One is, yes, there is a lot of technology that's picking up in terms of capacity in Africa, and so we have this potential of applying, you know, crowdsourcing and the GIS to be able to actually define infectivity patterns. We've seen in COVID-19 that not everyone really needs hospital care, so how we can have efficient methods for differentiated care is something that we can look at. And then, of course, vaccines is, never, I think, in history have we waited for a vaccine like now. So this way implementations comes in. We have a beautiful vaccine, 95% or 90% effective. How do we actually then use implementation science techniques to make sure that people receive it probably within 12 months? We can then, of course, make sure that, you know, we also use techniques that are appropriate to be able to measure the impact. And then, of course, predicting the next epidemics. So, yes, these are my few thoughts, and I would just like to thank you for your time and also for inviting me. Thank you very much.